midst of famine, who dwell in the midst of famine, who dwell in the midst of famine. Lead thy people with the rod, a flock of thine inheritance, who dwell solitary in the wood, in the midst of famine, who dwell in the midst of famine.
Chapter 24, verse 25. We had a reading from verse 13 to 32. Then Jesus said unto them, unto those disciples, to Cleophas and his friend, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into the glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. I don't know what all the things Jesus expounded unto him from the Old Testament. From Moses down to all the prophets who spoke concerning Jesus. That's why Peter says on the day of Pentecost, Acts chapter 2 verse 23, about Jesus, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God. Jesus Christ was delivered by the determinate counsel of God, by the determinate foreknowledge of God. Even Jesus said, it is recorded in the book of Hebrews, before Jesus came into this world, he told his father, his daddy, "Daddy, look, I come. The blood of oxen and lamb could not satisfy you. That cannot bring a total redemption to mankind. I know it is written of me in the volume of the book. I come." It was a prophecy given in Psalm 40 verse 7. My dear brother, my dear sister, in Revelation 19:10, in Revelation 19:10, the Bible says, the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. We read in Luke 24 verse 44, all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning him, concerning Jesus Christ. My dear brother, my dear sister, what we see here, Jesus was expounding the Old Testament prophecies concerning Jesus Christ and how they were fulfilled in the lives of Jesus Christ literally. My dear brother, my dear sister, this morning I'm going to show you some mathematical theories that would make you astonished. I try to make it as simple as possible. Some of you might have studied the theory of probability. The theory of probability is a science in mathematics. There was a professor by name Stoner. He had some findings and he has submitted his findings to the Committee of American Scientific Affiliation. He has given his findings and inferences to the Committee of the American Scientific Affiliation. So first let me tell you what is the theory of probability. Now just I throw a toss a coin for the head to come on the top, for the head to come up, the probability is 1 out of 2. Either head can come or tail can come. The probability of head to come up is, the chance is only 1 out of 2. We all can easily understand that. When I toss two coins, the probability of head to come in both the coins, head to be up on both the coins, is 1 out of 4 chances. Either it can be head in A and tail in B, or tail in A, head in B, or A and B, tail up, or it can be A and B, head up, only out of 4 chances. So getting head in the toss is only 1 out of 4 chances. It's a very simple. Suppose if there are 3 coins, and if you have a very simple an aptitude towards this calculation, head to come in all the 3 coins, the probability is only 1 out of 8. The chance of, the probability of getting a head is only 1 out of 8. My dear brother, my dear sister, if we had 4 coins, the probability will become 1 out of 16. And when we increase the conditions, only in the third row third throw. Only in the third throw, all three coins must have head. Then the probability increases much higher. Now here, when I talk about a coin, the probability is only head or tail. Only head or tail. But when we toss a dice, a cubical dice, a cubical dice has got 6 sides and 1 dot, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 like that. When I toss a coin, it's only, the probability is only 2, either head or tail. But when I toss a dice, to get 1 in 1 dice itself is 1 out of 6 times. When I toss 2 dice together, the probability increases much higher. My dear brother, my dear sister, I don't want to bombard you this morning with the theory of probability. Even to get 1 on the top, the probability is 1 out of 6. To get in both the dices 1 on the top, the probability is 1 out of 36. And when I increase the condition, in the first throw itself, both 1 must come. In the third throw, it must be both 3. In the fifth throw, in the first dice 2, in the second dice 5, even just you calculate with 2 dices, the probability of getting what we want, it will blow our minds. This professor and the team of his scholars, they studied the Bible prophecies and they have presented that to the American Society of Scientific Affiliation. In the days of Jesus, or 2000 years ago, as it was prophesied by Micah, a boy to be born in Bethlehem, a boy to be born in Bethlehem, please listen, it is 2.8 times 10 to the power of 5 chances. 1 out of 2.8 into 10 to the power of 5 chances. 10 to the power 5 means it is 1 and 5 zeros, 1 lakh. In other words, for a boy to be born in Bethlehem is approximately 3 lakhs chances. Only out of 3 lakh chances, only out of 3 lakh chances, a boy can be born in Bethlehem. The chances. There are at least 8 prophecies. There are at least 8 prophecies concerning the very birth of Jesus Christ. It is foretold. As I said earlier, 500 years before Jesus Christ was born, great Buddha was born. He was bringing in a great awakening. There are many followers. But before Buddha was born, there was no prophecy concerning Buddha's birth. 500 years after Muhammad was born, There were no prophecies concerning Muhammad about his birth. He also brought in a great awakening in the hearts of the people. He was able to turn people from idolatry and turn them to a loving God, an almighty God. My dear brother, my dear sister, about the very birth of Jesus Christ alone, there are 8 specific major prophecies. When will he born? Where will he born? He'll be in the tribe of Abraham. Among Abraham's children, he'll be in the tribe of Isaac. Among Isaac's 2 sons, he will be in the tribe of Jacob. Among the 12 sons Jacob had, he will be coming in the line of Judah. And the line of Judah itself was like the sand of the earth. He will be in the family of King David. He will be born in Bethlehem. My dear brother, my dear sister, for all these 8 prophecies, with the theory of probability to be fulfilled in one person, to be fulfilled in one person, is they have found out 10 to the power of 17 times. 10 to the power of 17. 1 and 17 zeros. What is this 10 to the power of 17? 1. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. Out of this big number, only all these prophecies can be fulfilled in one person. Now what I'm going to tell you will blow your mind. We talk wisdom. To the people of wisdom. Not the wisdom of the world, but the wisdom of heaven. Christianity is not a blind religion. There are, I just took only 8 prophecies. For 8 prophecies concerning the birth of Jesus Christ, or the birth of Messiah, to be fulfilled in that one man, Jesus, the chance is 1 out of 100, 10 raised to 17. My dear brother, my dear sister, you know there are how many prophecies concerning Jesus Christ in the Old Testament? They have identified 456 prophecies. 456 prophecies in the Old Testament speaking about one Messiah to come in the world. And that one Messiah, all these 456 prophecies are fulfilled in one man called Jesus, born in the house of Mary and Joseph. Out of these 456 prophecies, 48 prophecies are called major prophecies. He'll be born in Bethlehem. Daniel said, at the end of the 69th week, the Messiah will be cut off. Exact date. The 69th into 7 years, exactly from the degrees given to build the walls of Jerusalem, Jesus Christ was crucified. Exactly. Like that, there are 48 major prophecies they have identified. If all these 48 major prophecies in the Old Testament to be fulfilled in one man, Stoner has proved that it requires 10 to the power of 157 chances. Only out of 10 to the power of 157 chances that it can be fulfilled, that this Jesus, this Messiah is Jesus. If all these prophecies are to be fulfilled in one man, what an amazing fact it could be. Is it possible that with our human brains we can understand the existence of this man? The glory of this man? Can our brain hold the glory of this man? Because they could not contain it in their mind, they say they could not believe it. Many times, I can't see electrons. Electrons is smaller than atoms. I can't see electrons. Probably when I cannot prove electrons, I may come to a conclusion that the electrons don't exist. My dear brother, my dear sister, just I put a small line. You may not be able to see this line, maybe approximately 1 inch. In 1 inch line, the scientists say, in 1 inch line, there are 10 to the power of, I'm sorry. 2.5 times 10 to the power of 15 electrons. You all are educated people. I'm talking science. You all are educated people. In 1 inch, if you place electrons side by side, in 1 inch, there are electrons to the 2.5 into 10 to the power of 15 times. If somebody starts counting it at the rate of 250 electrons in a minute, and he counts it day and night, he counts 250 electrons in 1 minute, and he counts continually day and night, to count all the electrons in 1 inch, in 1 inch line, it will take 19 million years. 19 million years. If somebody could count 250 electrons in 1 minute, and he counts continually day and night, a man has to live for 19 million years to count all the electrons in 1 inch line. All the electrons 10 to the power of 15. To understand the prophecies, all the 448 prophecies fulfilled in Jesus, if it is 10 to the power of 157, just imagine, can a man live to all those years to understand Christ fully, unless he reveals himself to us? My dear brother, my dear sister. So the conclusion is, any man who rejects Christ as the Son of God is rejecting a fact. Any man who rejects Christ as the Son of God is rejecting a fact proved perhaps more absolutely than any other fact in the world. More than any other fact proved in the world. More than any other fact, Archimedes theory or whatever it may be. More than any other fact proved in the world. Scientifically proved fact is that Jesus is the Son of God. My dear brother, my dear sister, if you can't understand this theory fully, forget it. But you can be confident about one fact. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is that Messiah. Is scientifically true. This is what exactly Jesus was trying to do to those disciples going to Emmaus. It is Moses said like this, Daniel said like this, David said like this, Isaiah said like this, and all what they have said, this 456 predictions, have come upon that one person. Now, Cleophas, you trusted that Jesus will redeem Israel. But today you are sad. In one translation it says, they were walking downcast. It's not because they didn't have the message of the resurrection of Jesus. They said, some of our women, they went and saw the sepulchre empty. They heard the message through an angel that Jesus was risen. Even some of our friends went there, they found the sepulchre empty, but they didn't see the body. Once they trusted that Jesus would help them, Jesus would redeem Israel, now they are sad. The resurrection message, the message that Jesus is alive, through an angel, through some of their women, could not change their sadness, their disappointment. People walked with Jesus, talked with Jesus. People have seen his miracle. People have heard his words. They could not believe Jesus was alive. My dear brother, my dear sister, year by year, you can hear sermons that Jesus is alive. But you can be sad. You can be disappointed. You can be discouraged. Say, yes, I know Jesus is alive. I believe Jesus would solve this problem. I believe Jesus would open up a way for me. I believe Jesus could help me. They said, we believe Jesus could redeem Israel. But now we are sad. We are disappointed. My dear brother, my dear sister, I don't know how many prophecies Jesus expounded to them from the Old Testament to show that this Jesus is the promised Messiah. If Jesus were to show all those prophecies and explain that all those prophecies are fulfilled only in the life of Jesus, so because all these prophecies are fulfilled in that one man, to understand that will say take millions and millions and millions of years. My dear brother, my dear sister, this morning just I show you five prophecies. Last night I was very tired. After I had been to the convention at Sekhar, I was worn out. I knew very well the Sunday morning that I won't be able to preach. I contacted one pastor. He said he was not available. I contacted another pastor. He said he was not available. I knew the Lord would help me. I sat meditating the word of God. This thought the Lord put in my heart. I said, Lord, it's very difficult. I don't have strength. I don't have time to sit and prepare. But the Spirit of the Lord constrained me to show to the people, this Jesus is the Messiah. This Jesus is God. Fear not. As the time permits, I'll show you some of these Old Testament prophecies which are fulfilled in this one man called Jesus. We go to Genesis, in the Garden of Eden, chapter 3. man sinned, transgressed, ate the forbidden fruit, was running away from the face of the Almighty God. All love and affection, Almighty God came seeking after him, found him, started talking to him, explained to them the punishment they would get because they had chosen to transgress. Nevertheless, he was revealing his mercy to them. And he told Adam and Eve, Adam, Eve, I will put enmity between, he told the serpent, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, the serpent and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. That seed, it shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. In the Garden of Eden, God told the serpent, there will be enmity between you and the seed of the woman. Not the seed of man and women, not from the semen of men. Probably 4,000 years before Jesus could be born, before any prophet could prophesy about somebody who would be born of a virgin. It can't be just born in the mind of Moses that a day somebody will be born without the operation of a man. And Moses could imagine that that man, supernaturally born out of a woman, can bruise the head of Satan. That probably he could imagine. That Almighty God, through a great miracle, he can make a child born out of only women, and that child can destroy the works of Satan. Probably that can be imagined. But 4,000 years ago, can Moses, can Adam and Eve imagine? Or 3,000 years ago, can Moses imagine that Satan can give an excruciating agony to the chosen Messiah? How can he imagine that? Even if Moses could write out of his imagination, can Moses imagine, in a logical sense, that this Messiah who will crush the head of the serpent will also go through an excruciating agony in the police at the time of investigation? The cruelest punishment they can give to a person is make him lie down and with a big lathi to hit on the heels. All our nerves end on the heels. When a criminal is hit on the heels, the pain will vibrate from heels to head. That will be very excruciating, they say. My dear brother, my dear sister, so many thousands of years ago, God told that this Messiah will go through the agony of the cross. His heels will be crushed. His heels will be crushed. My dear brother, my dear sister, When we read Matthew chapter 1, verse 20, Gabriel tells Joseph, Mary is conceived, not of any man, it's the work of the Holy Ghost. It is the fulfillment of prophecy that was given in the Garden of Eden. A woman, there's so many millions of women in that day. In that day, Mary to be chosen, what could be that probability? That Mary, there's so many Marys, the Mary that is espoused to Joseph, that Mary to be chosen. There are so many Josephs, so many Marys. The Mary may be exposed to Joseph. This Joseph in the line of David. This Mary living in Nazareth. This Mary exposed to this Joseph. Joseph, she is conceived, not of a man. A prophecy given in the Garden of Eden was fulfilled in this man. And in Galatians chapter 4 verse 4, Paul, a great scholar, a Pharisee, who wanted to destroy this Christianity, who could not buy this theory that a man, Jesus, is God. He wanted to annihilate this cult. They are calling a man, Jesus, God. This Paul says, this Jesus was made of a woman. Was made of a woman. Why was this prophecy given? For me to know today, for me to know today, this Jesus delivers me from the curse that I inherited, from the sin that I inherited, He delivers me to have a victorious life. Satan is cursed, crushed. His head is crushed. He has got no more power and authority over me. Because Adam, in Adam, I ate that forbidden fruit. I obeyed to the voice of Satan in the Garden of Eden. This curse came upon me. I became a slave to Satan. Whether I commit sin or not, I am under death. I am under God's condemnation. But because of this promised Messiah, of whom it was spoken, of whom it was spoken in the Garden of Eden came, crushed the head of Satan. He got his heels crushed for me. I know that prophecy is fulfilled. No more I am under the bondage of Satan. Jesus explained this probably to the disciples. Is it not spoken of? Spoken in the book of Genesis, that the seed of women will come. Is it not spoken his heels will be crushed? I don't know what Jesus exactly expounded. I'm just expounding to you some of the prophecies to give you an encouragement. If that is true, Jesus is that Messiah prophesied in Genesis chapter 3. Then I got the confidence. When the heels of Jesus was crushed on the cross of Calvary. It is true. The head of Satan is also crushed. Number 2. Isaiah 7:14. That's a prophecy. Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. God will be born. He will be your deliverer. He will be with you. Don't think God is in heaven. God will walk with you. God will talk with you. A day will come. God will be your Messiah. God will be your deliverer. You may ask me a question. How do I know God is my deliverer? A child will be born out of a virgin without a husband. A woman who knew no husband, an empty womb, shall give birth to a male child. Earlier, it was a child, the seed of a woman. Now here in this, the prophecy is more specific. The probability for a child to be born out of a woman, a male child as a deliverer, that itself is a huge. And that should be born out of a virgin, it's very huge. And that male child born out of a virgin, that child born out of a virgin must be a son. Jesus was a son. To make it clear, I tell you, Jesus was circumcised. A girl baby cannot be circumcised. It is a proof. Jesus was a male child. My dear brother, my dear sister, he was not neither a boy nor a girl. He was a boy. He was circumcised. And they called his name Emmanuel. In Matthew 1:23. Matthew says, shall call his name, they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted, God with us. Because this prophecy, what Isaiah said 700 years before Jesus was born, was fulfilled in Jesus, we know God is with us. It is not only God crushed the head of Satan. This morning, we have got the confidence that this Jesus, the Messiah, is with us. Disciples, why are you downcast? You have got the message. You have got the message that Jesus is risen. But that very message is not a source of comfort. You are very sad. The women who went to the sepulchre said, Jesus is risen. They said, and angels have told them. They are not lying. Nevertheless, you could not believe. They believed, but they could not believe. But when he expounded the scriptures, how what was prophesied of him in the Old Testament fulfilled in this one man, Jesus, their hearts started glowing. I show you one prophecy, the third one. Deuteronomy 18:15. It's a very powerful prophecy. Deuteronomy 18:15. The Lord thy God will raise up unto you a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren, like unto me. Unto him you shall hearken. Listen, listen, listen. I can understand what you feel. So he was just a prophet like Moses. Moses said, a prophet like me will rise up from the midst of you, your brethren, from Israel. Maybe a star of Jacob, a lion of Judah, the seed of Abraham, through Isaac. But he was just like a prophet. He was just a prophet like Moses. There were so many prophets. From the midst of his brethren came. There was King David. There was Nathan, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Zechariah, Haggai, Malachi, so many prophets. And the greatest prophet, John the Baptist. Jesus is also one of the prophets. Please listen. He didn't say God will raise up a prophet from Israel, from the midst of thee. He said, a prophet like unto me. Can you see something different in it? There was Isaiah, David, they all gave prophecies. 1,000 years before Jesus was born, David was giving a vivid explanation of the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, how nails will be driven through his hands and his feet. Please listen, in the days of David, there was no execution called crucifixion. David had never seen in his life a man's hands and feet were nailed to a tree in all his days. He's never heard about it. So he didn't talk about something, some cruel thing that he knew. He didn't know. He had never seen a man crucified. Crucifixion may be a very simple fact for us. We have seen pictures. We have read books how a man is crucified. But David had never seen. David had never heard. David had no knowledge about crucifixion. A man is pinned to that tree. He has given such a vivid prophecy about the death of Jesus. But Moses said, not David. Isaiah 53, a very clear picture of how Jesus would die. But not Isaiah. Moses said, a prophet like me. You can please sit straight and listen what it is, a prophet like Moses. Among all the prophets in the Old Testament, Moses was the only prophet who redeemed people from bondage. Moses was the only prophet, he gave them a covenant to the people through the blood of the sacrificial lamb. Isaiah never did it. David never did it. Ezekiel never did it. Only Moses was the deliverer and the covenant maker. A prophet like me will come. One who can deliver people from the bondage. And one who will give a new covenant. That's what Jesus said. Cleophas, don't you know that? This is a new covenant. A covenant that is made with my blood. Moses made a covenant with the blood of a lamb. This prophet, like unto Moses, made a covenant with the people with his blood. That is why the greatest prophet, greatest among all men, said, look, this is the Lamb that taketh away the sin of the world. This is the Lamb that taketh away the sin of the world. That prophecy was not fulfilled in Isaiah. That prophecy was not fulfilled in Jeremiah. That prophecy was not fulfilled in any other religious man. That prophecy was not fulfilled in anybody else. The only deliverer and one who made the law to the people in was Moses. And like unto Moses, one who deliver people, one who can bring God's law, a new commandment, love one another, was given to the people only by this great Messiah. That's why Peter says, Acts 3:22, for Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren like unto Moses, him shall you hear in all things whatsoever he shall say unto you. My dear brother, my dear sister, this prophecy is not fulfilled in anybody else. Just imagine a child to be, a seed to be born of a woman, that seed to be a man, that seed to be a deliverer, that man not only a deliverer, who makes a new covenant, who brings a new law. I can go on and on and on. Isaiah 9, verses 1 and 2. Even the very simple meditation of a few prophecies fulfilled was giving a lot of confidence, strength in my heart. This morning, when I got up, my lips were singing, Majesty, I worship your majesty. Not because it is later for today's singing. Lord, you are God. Jesus, you are God. It's not because just my religion has shown to me. Not just because got a fabulous proof, a fascinating proof to show that Jesus is God, but because he lives in me. Hallelujah. Isaiah 9, verse 1 and 2, it speaks about the seed of the woman, the son of a virgin, a prophet, like unto Moses, deliverer of the people, one who makes a covenant, one who brings a new commandment. I can go on and on. About that Messiah, we read in chapter 9, verse 1 and 2, nevertheless, the dimness shall not be such as was in her vexation, when at the first he lightly afflicted the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterward did more grievously afflict her by the way of the sea, beyond Jordan, in Galilee of the nations. Please listen. The people that walked in darkness, that is in Zebulun and Naphtali, in the Galilee of the nations, the people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them had the light shined. They were in darkness. They were in affliction. They were in the shadow of death. A prophecy was given. A light shall appear in them. They shall see a great marvelous light walking through the length and the breadth of their nations, which is in darkness. The seed of a woman, the son of a virgin, the prophet like unto Moses, was not born in was not walking in Jerusalem alone, was not walking only in Samaria. To the fulfillment of the prophecy, this seed of a woman, the son of a virgin, that rabbi like Moses started his ministry. He came dwelling in Capernaum, and he started his ministry on the sites of the shores of Galilee for the fulfillment of the prophecy within the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali. So Matthew says in verse 14, why did he start his ministry on the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali? He could have started his ministry anywhere. He could have started in what area also? This seed of a woman, the son of a virgin, a prophet like unto Moses, started his ministry on the borders of Naphtali and Zebulun, on the nations of Galilee, for the fulfillment of prophecy. Matthew says in 4:14 that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people which sat in darkness saw great light, and to them which sat in the region and shadow of death, light is spring up. Brother, sister, this Jesus bring light in your darkness. You are in the shadow of death. He is life eternal. You are sitting in darkness. He is the light that no darkness can swallow it. Fear not. Fear not. He crushes the head of serpent. This great Emmanuel is with you always, even when you walk through the valley of the shadow of death. He is your deliverer. He is your covenant maker. He gives a new commandment: love one another as you love yourself. And He is your light. On this day, when the whole world remembers the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you have got a message. This Jesus is that Messiah. My dear brother, my dear sister, a fact, an absolute fact, a fact that is greater than any other fact. It is a scientific fact greater than Newton's theory of gravitation. It is a greater fact than Einstein's theory of relativity. It is a greater fact than the principles of Archimedes. My dear brother, my dear sister, it is a fact. This seed of a woman, the son of a virgin, is God. I just say one more thing before we could pray. Isaiah 61, verses 1 and 12. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. I told you what Peter said about him. I told you what Paul said about him. I told you what Matthew and Luke told about him. Jesus told about that Messiah to the disciples of Emmaus. And now I'm going to show you what Jesus himself told about himself openly. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Jesus opened up the Bible and took a passage that shone about him. He read that passage. The Bible says that all ears could hear that. He closed the book and he told them, this day, this prophecy concerning me is fulfilled. Luke has recorded that. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. That's why people got annoyed. It's a prophecy about Messiah. This man, son of a carpenter, says this prophecy, this day is fulfilled in him. Is he that Messiah? You want to believe Jesus? Believe Jesus. If you can't believe Jesus, leave it. Great statesmen, politicians, atheists may call Jesus a good man. A good man. We can ask them a question. You say Jesus is a good man. He followed Jesus' teachings. This Jesus said, the prophecy of Isaiah chapter 61 is fulfilled in him when he started the ministry in Capernaum. Do you believe that? Do you believe that prophesied Messiah is this Jesus? You believe Jesus is a good man. Then Jesus says this prophecy is fulfilled in me. As Josh McDowell put, there are three alternatives. Either Jesus must be a liar to say that prophecy was fulfilled in him. Or Jesus must be lunatic to say that prophecy was fulfilled in him. Or the third alternative, Jesus is not a liar. If Jesus is not lunatic, then Jesus is the Lord. Then Jesus is the Lord. That prophecy was fulfilled in Jesus. What is that prophecy? The Spirit of the Lord is upon Jesus. Why? God has anointed Jesus to preach good news to the poor. This morning you got a good news. And God has sent this prophet, this seed of a woman, the son of a virgin, to heal the brokenhearted. You got a good news. You got a healing of the broken hearts. This son of a virgin, he will deliver the captives. The Son of God sets you free, you shall be free indeed. Last week you heard the testimony of Brother Jones, Gunams Jones, a drunkard, a drug addict, a gangster, a chain smoker, one was sporting with a knife between his skin and socks. God delivered him. This Jesus is the Messiah who delivered people from their captivity. One who gives sight to the blind. One who set liberty to them that are bruised. One who can show the things that are to come to pass. This Jesus is Lord. Just I showed you five prophecies of the Old Testament. Five prophecies in the Old Testament concerning Jesus. How all these five prophecies were fulfilled in one man. They called him Jesus. Just imagine, 48 major prophecies are fulfilled in this one man. And they have identified 456 Old Testament prophecies fulfilled in this one man. And this Jesus, hallelujah, is your Lord and is my Lord. We are worshipping a living Savior. So he was telling those disciples, if you can believe all these prophecies, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, 6, 7, If we can believe all these prophecies was fulfilled in that one man, that was a prophecy by David, that God will not allow to see the death or the decay of his beloved. Don't you believe that? Didn't David say that? Didn't David say that he will raise up his beloved from the dead? If you can believe all these prophecies fulfilled in Jesus, can't you believe that according to the prophecies, God made Jesus rise up from the dead? He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead. Are you brokenhearted? Are you in darkness? Are you sitting in the shadow of death? In captivity? Fearing that you are left alone? God is not with you. The risen Savior is a fulfillment of the prophecies. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen.